Want to say good morning to everybody in PT North today as well. Can you say amen in PT North? Amen. I was so loud up there. I literally, could you hear them? We could just hear them all the way down here at PT this morning. That was what I heard. Wasn't that what I heard? Amen. It's good to see everybody online today as well. We can't visibly see you, but glad that you're with us today. I want to say this morning that I have grown up all my life in church. It's all I have ever known is going to church because my dad was a pastor. And some tough questions that will be asked to someone like myself, they'll ask me, well, when did you give your life to God? Well, it just seems like I always have given my life to God ever since I was a child. And I've often told people I've been in church so much. Some of the best gum I ever chewed when I was a kid was off the bottom of church pews. Not really. But just being there. And, you know, you see a lot of strange things in church over the years. And a lot of things that I have seen in church over the years, we don't see any longer. Different. I mean, today, I can say over 50 years ago, I've been going to church over 50 years, things are much different in church today than they were 50 years ago. Drastically. Can everybody say, thank God? Some things they maybe are not as good as they used to be, but most things are. But I want to talk to you about something this morning that I have heard all of my life. It's a little cliche, and people will say, maybe you've said it as a Christian. But I want to talk to you this morning about imitators of Christ. And hopefully you're taking that in the right connotation, and I'll explain it in a moment. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1, be imitators of me as I am of Christ. That's what Paul said. Be imitators of me as I imitate Christ. All of my life, I've heard people make this statement. Well, I just want to be more like Jesus. I just want to be more like him. What they're actually saying, what they actually mean, is I want to be Christ-like, or I want to be an imitator of Christ. 1 John chapter 2, verse 6, whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. Imitators of Christ. Now, becoming more Christ-like is a result of your spiritual growth. As you grow spiritually, you'll be more like him. When you first give your life to Christ, we are immature in our wisdom and in our knowledge. We're also inexperienced in our grace and our love. You will find the older you get and the greater your relation gets with God, the more grace and love you're going to show people. People, I have often noticed when they first come to Christ, they give their life to Christ, they're very quick to start to judge other people. But as you get older, you realize that's not our job anyhow, to judge other people, and we show more grace and more love when we grow. And when we grow in grace and wisdom and knowledge of God's word, we are carrying out what the word of God says, 1 Thessalonians 3 and 12. And may the Lord make you increase and abound in love to one another and to all, just as we do to you. So to be imitators of Christ, you're going to be Christ-like. You're also going to have the mind of Christ. Now, not literally you say, oh, I'm going to be brilliant like God is. No, you're going to think different in your thinking. The Bible says in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. What was in his mind? What did he think like? Who, being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And he literally came down to this earth and washed the dirty, muddy feet of humans. He did that, even though he was God. One of the least understood phrases among Christians today is, I want to be more like Jesus. People don't really understand what they're saying. No, there's nothing wrong with saying that. I just don't think that a lot of people really have a clue, a sweet clue, what it means to be an imitator of Christ or Christ-like. Now, our religious churched culture has grown up with a very safe picture of Jesus. Like some of these pictures behind me. Took those offline. Jesus had nice feathered hair. You see the guy in the middle? He looks like Fabio. You know, there he is. We have the picture of Jesus that he wore a white flowing robe with a nice sash all around it. constant giver of hugs, and he always carried a lamb, you know? It's like this one down here. You always see him carrying a lamb wherever he went. These are safe, religious, churched pictures of Jesus. However, when I read the Bible, I don't see these pictures. I'm serious. I don't see that stuff. I mean, they make him look like he's, you know, effeminate at times up here. And these are pictures that we see. We see them sometimes in churches and stained glass windows. To be imitators of Christ, we're going to have to drop our Sunday school perception and embrace who Jesus really was. First of all, you want to imitate Christ. He was passionate about his beliefs. Very passionate. Revelation chapter 19 gives us a picture of Jesus. Future picture, but you had a picture of Jesus. Revelation 19 and 11. Now I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. And he who sat on him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. Did you get that? Jesus coming. His eyes were like the flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood. His name is called the Word of God. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, and with it he should strike the nations. He himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of the Almighty God, and he has on his robe and on his thigh the name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Challenge you, Celestino. This is the best I can find online. Let's see the next picture. You know, come up with a picture that really looks like the coming Savior, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, on a white horse, powerful, dynamic, with the angelic beings of heaven coming with him. You see, these are not the pictures that you usually see in the Christian bookstores, are they? You usually see that really fine, fair-looking Jesus. Listen, in Matthew chapter 21, I'm not going to read it this morning, but you can read that chapter, especially 12 through to 16. Jesus was passionate for his love for the house of God. He went to the temple, and when he went to the temple, they were buying and selling their sacrifices. They would say to themselves, well, you know, I don't have anything at home. I'll just go and buy something before I go in the temple. I'll buy a turtle dove or I'll buy a little lamb. And those that were selling were putting the prices up. They were making money off that. Jesus comes along and he sees this and he said, this is my house. You're making it a place of sacrilege. Take a look at this little clip that we have here today. This is Jesus, what he did.
Take these things hence! Make not my Father's house an house of merchandise!
Jesus was passionate in what he believed. A lot of times people don't talk about that, you know, he literally made a whip at this scene as well. And he was whipping them, get out of my temple, you've made it a den of thieves. He's passionate. We need to be passionate about what we believe in. If you're going to be Christ-like, if you're going to be an imitator of Christ, you're going to be passionate. God is a passionate God. Some things God is passionate about, he loves. Some things God hates, he's also passionate about. As you become more Christ-like in your life, he will give you a passion for things. Seriously. If you have no passion in your life for anything that God has laid upon your heart, then there's something wrong with your relationship with God. He will give you a passion for things. So don't say, oh, Jesus, I want to be more like you. If you say that, God's going to give you a passion for something. And you're going to be so passionate that you're going to just work at it and work at it and work at it and have it on your heart and your mind day and night. It may be a passion about a problem. We have a lot of problems in our world today. And I believe that God will give the church a passion for it. Maybe it's a purpose that you have in your life. God has called you for a specific purpose. God will make you passionate about that. Or a principle in your life, a way that you live your life. God will make you passionate about that. Or maybe a group of people. God will make you passionate. I have some passionate things that I'm passionate about. I'm passionate about souls of men and women. I want to see people come to Christ. Because I realize if they don't come to Christ, they're lost. I told some people yesterday, I told my wife on the way home from the funeral, I love doing funerals. You don't have to all die this week to make me happy. But I love to do funerals, and I'll tell you why. That is the time that people, all people, for a few moments, will sit down and realize someday that's going to be me. That's going to be me. And I challenge them, are you ready for that day? Are you ready to close your eyes for the last time? I am passionate about souls. I'm also passionate for those that can't speak for themselves. The unborn baby, I'm passionate about that. Man, I love it. I hear every once in a while the new grandchild that's on its way to the Pangburn household, and they'll play me that little heart beating, like just boom, 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 boom. You know what that heart says to me? I'm here. I'm here and I want to live. And every child that is conceived is the same way. I'm passionate for those that can't speak for themselves. You know me, I'm passionate about Israel because I believe that's God's country. I shared about it last week. You see, you cannot keep yourself from talking about things that you are passionate about. And if you're going to be Christ-like, he's going to make you passionate for something. Wow, you get quiet on there. P.T. North, can you say amen? Amen. Thank you, P.T. North, for that this morning. Matthew 12 and 34. The mouth speaks the things that are in the heart. What's in your heart is going to be your main conversation. You're going to talk about that most of the time. Again and again and again and again. Because it's in your heart. David said this in Psalm 69 and 9. He said, my zeal for God and his work burns hot within me. Zeal for his God and God's work. Jeremiah said, your message burns in my heart and bones, and I cannot keep silent. Passionate, passionate. Christian who's imitating Christ is someone that is passionate for the things of God. And every once in a while, when you get passionate, you're going to have to turn some tables over. Can you say amen? I have found that in my lifetime. I've had services that I preached on something that I've been passionate about, and I realized the next day on Monday morning, I got some phone calls, I turned some tables over. That happens every once in a while, but I usually don't back up. I just say, that's what I believe. I am passionate about it. God has laid it on my heart. You want to imitate Christ? You're going to be passionate about your beliefs. Also, secondly, if you want to imitate Christ, remember Jesus offended the religious. He really did. The religious crowd, the religious of his day, of his religion, he offended them. Matthew chapter 22, verse 15. Then the Pharisees went and plotted how they might entangle him in his talk. And they sent to him their disciples with the Herodians, saying, get this, teacher, we know that you are true and teach the way of God in truth. Nor do you care about anyone, for you do not regard the person of men. You know what I've often found? The religious will puff you up before they tear you down. I'll throw that into this morning. We're going to read more. They're always that way. They come behind. Oh, love you, pastor. You're so good. You're so wonderful. And then, anyways, we're going to move on. Verse 17. Tell us, therefore, What do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? But Jesus perceived their wickedness and said, why do you test me, you hypocrites? How would you like that? You know, you talk with somebody, they call them, hey, Celestine, how you doing, you hypocrite? They say that so because I can get away with it. But how would you like that? Show me the tax money. So they brought him a denarius. And he said to them, whose image and inscription is on this little coin? And they said to him, Caesar's. And he said to them, render therefore to Caesar the things that are Caesar, and to God the things that are God's. And when they heard these words, they marveled, and they left him and went their way just to get ready to come back and challenge him again. Keep something in mind. Always remember this. It wasn't the atheists or the agnostics or the devil worshipers of Jesus' day that crucified him. It wasn't. It was the most religious people of his religion that killed him. Not some other religion, but of the Jewish religion that killed him. Why in the world would they kill Jesus? Is it because he was always such a nice guy? No, that's not the reason at all that they killed Jesus. Here's some of the reasons why they hated him and finally they killed him. One reason was he healed on Sunday. God forbid that. He did good works on Sunday, which in their mind was sinful because on Sunday, oh, we can't do anything. Just sit home and sit on the couch. That's all you can do. Listen, don't miss that these people missed a miracle because he didn't fit into their formula. Boy, it's so easy in religion to start getting little boxes and formulas, and everything has to fit within that formula. I met the pastor of the church yesterday that I had the funeral at, and he's only been there 8 months. I said, you're still honeymooning. He said, well, he said, I think we'd come just about to the end of that period, he said. But he told me that, he said, I never wear a tie. I said, well, God bless you. I don't either. I said, you might even make it to heaven if you're a real good boy. But, you know, some people might not go to his church or might get upset in his church because he doesn't wear a tie. How sad is that? Seriously. You know, these people in Jesus' day, they considered Jesus wrong for doing what was right, for doing good things on the Sabbath day. And he asked them the question, if you remember the story in the Bible, he said, is it God's will to do good or evil on the Sabbath day? You know, he kind of boxed them in. Another reason why they didn't like Jesus went to the hurting of society. He didn't hang around with a hierarchy of the religious crowd. You know, those with the big robes on and the big hats on of his day and going around and everybody was, oh, God bless you, bless me and all that. He didn't hang around with them. He hang around with the hurting of society. He even went, God forbid, and he touched lepers. There's some major consequences. And you know, I preached on it before. If anybody touched a leper, that he'd have to go through afterward. It was a no-no of his time. He also went to the house of a tax collector who was known as a sinner and had a meal. And there were many sinful people, the Bible says, that were at the meal with him. He was making a social declaration that I will be with, and I will eat with, and I will fellowship with sinners. Why? That's who he came for. He also went off on the religious crowd, Matthew chapter 23, and he called the Pharisees whitewashed tombs. He called them sons of hell. He called them vipers or snakes. That's not going to make the religious crowd really happy. Can you say amen? Jesus was not concerned with making the religious of his day happy. By the way, you will never make a religious spirit happy. They're always going to have an issue with something. So if you're going to be an imitator of Christ, you must understand right up front that the religious crowd is likely not going to be your fan. So you want to imitate Christ? Third thing, Jesus focused outward, not inward. Satan has no problem this morning with us going to church. PT North, Satan has no problem with you going to church. Here's what Satan has a problem with. When those that go to church start stepping on his territory and telling people about Christ, that's when he really gets royally ticked off. Every single time. Bible says in Proverbs 29:18, where there is no vision, the people perish. I believe that our vision cannot be in Praise Tabernacle within the church, Praise Tabernacle North. It has to be outside the walls of our church. People did not wake up this morning on a 16-degree morning in Rhode Island thinking, oh boy, I want to go to church today. Most Christians woke up and thought, oh my word, I think I'll watch this online today. It's just not the way it is. Jesus had a focus, and his focus was the world, the people of the world. Watch anything that turns your focus inward. It more than likely has its beginning in the pits of hell. When it turns your focus inward. John 3:16, God sent his son into the world. Can you say amen? Careful when you get inward. You get inward looking at each other. We got all kinds of stuff that we can pick at all the time. We can pick at each other, what they wear, what they smell like, you know, what they work at, who they hang around with. We can just pick at people. That's inward focus. How do you praise Tabernacle? How do you praise Tabernacle North? How do you look at your church? How do you look at it? Maybe you come to church and you think, well, someone is sitting where I always like to sit. I always sit there. And that ruins your whole praise and worship experience. Oh, my word. I didn't get to sit where I wanted to sit. Oh, I hate sitting here. Oh, what am I going to do? Maybe I should find another church. Maybe you should. Or, you know, I just don't like the song that they sang. I don't like that song. It's not a song that I like. I hate when they sing that song. And that ruins your praise and worship experience. Well, you know, the pastor should have a suit on up there in the pulpit today. I think we're over that by now. We better be. Can you say amen? Amen. Or, you know, that's not my style of music. Big whippy deal. When you come to this church, we don't give you a little form to fill out. What style of music would you like for us to lullaby you with? That's not what we do. They never play my style of music in this church. They never play my style of music in PT North either. Never. But they will when we get to heaven. Can you say amen? It'll be country music in heaven. Can you say amen? But that's not it. I worship God, whether they sing Hillsong or they sing Elevation or whether they sing some old song. I don't care. Really, I don't care. I'm here to worship God. Because I am not going to allow myself to get inward focus. When you get inward focus, wow, did he preach out of the King James or the New King James or the NIV? Listen, all this is nothing more than good old-fashioned selfishness. That's all it is. Selfishness. People want their own way, and it's a type of control. Oh, I miss the old songs. I do too, but they're gone, you know. They just don't do them in church anymore. So what? But I tell you what I can do. I can get in my truck. I have a CD that I just purchased not too long ago on iTunes, and there's this country singer, and he promised his mother, if he ever made it famous, that he would do a gospel album. So he's got this CD, and he's got all the old songs, you know, Just a Closer Walk with Thee and Amazing Grace and all those old songs. So I put it in my truck and I play it. I worship God in my office. I put that on. I come to church, you know, they're singing whatever they're singing. I say, I'm going to praise God here. Because I came here not to worship a worship leader or a band. I came here to worship Jesus. Praise Tabernacle exists for the salvation of souls. That's why we have this building here today. Remember, we were even the old church. I had a little tour of the old church this week, and I went in there and I looked at it, and boy, that's a small sanctuary, ladies and gentlemen, in there. Small sanctuary. God has blessed us. But I used to say this. We used to have four services at one time in that building on Sunday. And I used to say, you know, someday God's going to bless us and give us a new church, but we're going to have more chairs in that church, more people can sit there, because I'm interested in having some empty seats so that we can fill those empty seats. Now, that's a good segue for this service this morning. We got some empty seats. Usually always do in the first service. Second service gets a little tough to find a seat in here. But y'all need to work at filling these seats for the first service. 8:30 service. Can you say amen? We got one bus, but we got two buses. We got three buses out there. We can load them up as well and get people to come to the house of God. PT North, it's the same way. Fill those empty seats. Praise Tabernacle. Praise Tabernacle North. We exist for the salvation of souls. When Jesus entered into a city, where would he always go? You go to the state house, city hall, you go to the mall. Where'd he go? He always went to the temple. First place he went to the temple. See what was going on in the temple first. The religious of his day were inward focused, and they couldn't even recognize the Messiah when he came and sat in their temple service. Can you imagine? They're praying in their prayer shawls. You know, Messiah come, Messiah come, Messiah come. Messiah walks right in. How you doing? Sits down in the temple. They couldn't see him. Why? Inward focused. They had in their mind and packaged it up. Here's the way it's going to happen. He's going to be like this, 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 and this. And they developed that. Religion can do that, you know. Religion can make an idol out of almost anything, give it enough time. And he walked right past them, and they didn't even realize that the Messiah is here. Be careful. Jesus can come by the presence of his Holy Spirit into this room. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. Could be a Wednesday night service. It could be an early Sunday morning, 11 o'clock. Could be a live it up service. Never know. It could be a worship service. You say, I really don't like the music in this service. But Jesus could walk in there and you miss him. You miss him. We have made the church a waiting room for saints instead of a hospital for the sick. It's not a waiting room for you and I. I refuse to just constantly preach to the same people. Thank God I don't have to do that at Praise Tabernacle North. I read something after a man this week, and he wrote, and it's really good. He said there are three types of growth in the church. Number one, there's natural growth. That's when families have children, you know, little babies, and they come in, and that's automatic growth, you know. In a few weeks here, Smiling, she's going to have her little baby. That'll be another little baby in Praise Tabernacle Church. Jelani's going to have her little one in a few weeks here. That'll be another little baby in Praise Tabernacle Church, another little life. That's natural growth. Second one is unnatural growth. That's when disgruntled Christians come to your church after leaving another church. That happens all the time. Do you realize the numbers for growth in America today in churches, I'm just saying America, are so skewed that it doesn't even make sense? Here's what the problem is people report their church growth for a year, but it's people that left this church and went to this church. That's technically not growth in the kingdom of God. You can come in here on a Sunday and say, you know what, next Sunday, my son and I talked about that this week. Next Sunday, we're going to have John Hagee. He's going to come speak at Praise Tabernacle Church. You know what would happen? This place would be packed. Packed with Christians. With Christians. That's who's going to come, Christians. We're going to have Steve Furtick. He's going to come. He's going to preach at Praise Tabernacle Church. Place would be packed with Christians. But the Sunday after, all those Christians are going to go back to their church. What was the purpose of that? What was the purpose of that? Just so we could entertain Christians or get Christians to come to our church? So unnatural growth, disgruntled Christians coming from another church. But the third type of growth that he mentioned is spiritual growth. That's when believers reproduce by winning souls to Christ. Everybody in this room this morning, you have friends. Everybody that's in PT North this morning, you have friends, people that you work with every day. If you will, talk with them and share your gospel with them. The gospel of Jesus Christ with them. And they will say, you know what? I'm hungry about that. And invite them to come to the house of the Lord. All of a sudden, you know, the Holy Spirit's going to reach out, touch their heart. They're going to give their life to Christ. How it happens every single time. When Jesus went to a city, he went to the heart of the problem. He went to the church. Because you see, it's a spiritual problem. If you're here this morning and you have issues with anything, you know, what's guy doesn't wear the tie or the worship service or whatever it might be, somebody sitting in your seat, spiritual problem. Spiritual problem. You need to get on your knees and talk to God about it, and God will work on you. if you want to be an imitator of Christ. When the church cleans up its act, then all of a sudden the church will have an influence on the city around it and the places around it. Jesus had a purpose, and his purpose was to reach people. Matthew chapter 28, 19, Jesus said, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations." Think of that. Jesus had a desire to reach the nations. In Acts chapter 1, verse 8, this is not on the screen this morning, but he said, "To go to the ends of the earth." That's reaching a lot of people. Always makes me kind of laugh sometimes when people say, "Well, you know, I'm not really into big churches. We just want to have some real good truth-believing people." But Jesus said, "Go win the nations." How do you win the nations and not have a church of a pretty good size? And if you're constantly winning souls and winning souls to Jesus Christ, you're going to have to make room for them. Can you say amen? Jesus told three parables in Luke chapter 15. And the three parables were about lost things. It was the lost coin, lost sheep, and the lost son. You know the stories. Sold everything to go find the lost coin. He left all of his other sheep to find that one sheep that was lost. That son that was lost that came back, he had that great celebration. My son was lost, but now he is found. You see, the context of those three parables in the 15th chapter of Luke talk about reaching the lost. That's the whole context. Then Jesus declares in that chapter how heaven feels when we win the lost. He doesn't declare how he feels about our worship service or about how good the preacher preached or about how many ministries I have in the church. He doesn't talk about that. Here's what he talks about. This is how heaven feels, and he's talking about lost things, people coming to Christ. Luke 15 and 7, Jesus said, "I say to you that likewise there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 just persons who need no repentance." God doesn't get excited. We just have a big number of Christians come together. Now, there are times for that. Times for encouragement. Times for inspiration. Times for education. To better us to go out and win the lost. Nothing wrong with that. But that's not what the church is about. The church is about winning the lost for Jesus Christ. Luke chapter 19, verse 10. "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save those who are lost." Be very careful you don't allow yourself to inward think all the time. It's out there, out there. Check your heart. Hell is hot, ladies and gentlemen. People are going to be lost for all eternity. How could someone not care about people that are stepping into eternity? How could you not care? Heard one man say, he said, "If I could build a church anywhere," he said, "I would build a church 100 meters from the gates of hell. And I would preach to them, listen, don't allow yourself to be lost. Challenge the authority of hell. Challenge the authority of hell in your homes. Don't allow hell to rule in your homes, with your families. Challenge the authority of hell. In our church, I challenge the authority of hell all the time. I refuse to say, no, it can't be done. Yes, it can be done in Jesus' name. People are hungry for God. They told me when I moved down into New England, they said, you know, they're awful hard down in New England. There's some little small churches down in there. You know, I refuse to believe that. And I have found that there are people that are hungry for Jesus. I believe that we need to rebuke the authority of hell in our schools and with our children. Amen. At the workplace. You are the child of God. You need to walk with a little godly swagger. Can you say amen? Amen. Imitators of Christ focus outward, not inward. You want to imitate Christ? You need to offer forgiveness and not condemnation. That's what he did. John 3:17. "For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." Religion and the religious crowd always wants us to sit on the judgment seat. You'll find that all the time. Those that have a religious spirit are constantly judging others. I had a guy in Canada years ago. He's dead now. He used to come to me. And he'd say, "Pastor, I don't want to gossip, but." He would do that all the time. That was the difference maker. That's the excuse maker. That makes it okay. The but factor, you know. "Pastor, I don't mean to be gossiping, but here it comes. Let me have it. Here it comes," you know. The religious crowd, they have a real hard time because they always want to judge. They want to judge you. They want to judge the church you go to. They want to judge the preacher you listen to. They want to judge the music you listen to. They want to judge who you hang around with. They want to judge what you wear. That's religious spirit. You get that this morning? Be careful of that. Jesus did not come to condemn the world, but the world through him might be saved. The religious crowd brought a woman to Jesus and wanted him to condemn her. They had caught her in the act of adultery. They were just likely waiting for it to happen. Oh, we caught her, and they brought her, and they said, she has done this act. She needs to be killed. She needs to be stoned. That's what the law said. They wanted him to condemn her. Religion will always want you to judge things and condemn things. That's the spirit behind that. Jesus said, after all those accusers had gone away, he said, you have the first, doesn't have any sin in them, you chuck the first stone at her. You know, in other words, we all sin. Thank you, Molly. Molly and I are the only sinners in here this morning. Come on. PT North, PT, we all sin. Can you say amen? Amen? We're not perfect. We won't be perfect until we get to the other side. Check this out. The people that Jesus had the most patience and the most time for were the broken, the poor, the outcasts, and the sinners, those that society would throw away, those that the church would say, you're not welcome in here. That's why we have in our parking lot, where you're always welcome. Because I want people to realize that in here. And that the day that the church ever comes to the place where they say, or PT North, well, there's certain people that we don't want to come to the house of the Lord. Toodly-doo, Toyota, I'm going to find a place to preach to sinners. Can you say amen? Jesus didn't yell at them. He didn't look down his nose at them. He didn't get all upset and say, why in the world are they sitting in a church pew today? I believe that excites God when sinners come to church. That's why we need to be on our best behavior when sinners come and treat them with honor and respect so that they can come to Christ and so that we don't turn them off. Amen. He offered them forgiveness. Someone goes through a failure in their life. The church should be there to help them up according to the Word of God. The Bible says, you who are spiritual should lift them up, help them up. The Bible talks about everything that we do, even the gifts of the Spirit that we use. What's it used for? To edify, lift up people. Jesus never told them their behavior was okay. They don't come in here and I say, you know what, your sin is all right, that's not a problem. He preached repentance, but he also did not condemn them. Bad people come into the church. I know they are living a sinful life. I know that. I have couples that come in here that are same-sex couples. They'll come up the door and I'll say, hey, how are you today? Good to see you. So glad that you're with us today. You know? And I'll talk about something that I know that is relevant to them at the door, because many times that's the only place I get to see people is at the door. You have to understand that. You know, as a shepherd, that is my responsibility. People say, well, Pastor, I don't understand why you're different. I've seen evangelists, and they do this. And listen, I am a shepherd of this church, and I only get to meet people once a week, most of them. Once a week. And the only relationship that I can build is sometimes at the door. You know? And so when they go out by, I know that they're not living a life that is according to the Word of God, but I'm going to love them. I'm going to love them. Love them. Jesus never said their behavior was okay, but he preached repentance. He didn't condemn them. Jesus was a restorer. I mentioned earlier before the offering, the greatest method of growth is giving. Did you know that? Sowing. Greatest method of growth. If you have this spring and you plant some seed in the ground, you plant it in the ground, and then what you harvest in the fall, you can take some of that seed and plant even more seed. Because it multiplies and multiplies and multiplies. That is the law of harvest. Praise Tabernacle, this church, PT North, we are in the business of restoring lives. And when we give out to people and give out to people and restore lives, it's coming back to us. We got chips coming out of our wazoo here in this church. Why? Because we started giving out chips. Do you realize, I've heard that testimony, my son has used that testimony in different places than just here, how God has blessed us in so many ways that we've given out and given out and given out and given out and given out. I was to our old building that we had this week, walked in through it, and we used every single inch of that building. Every inch. Pastor Dave was in there with me. We went up into where they had the belfry, and we put an office up there. We literally had an office in the belfry. Levi used to have that for an office. And then above him, there was a little loft that was built there to stack stuff that we had for Live It Up and for, I think, some Dream Center stuff was up there. And then above that, where the original bell was, we had all of these clothes that were up in there as well. Clothes and rats we had up in that area of the church. But every little place. And I looked, and my office originally, when we came to Praise Tabernacle, was right behind the platform. But then we just got so, you know, large, and we had so many things that we were trying to do. I said, you know what, I don't need this office here. I'm going to go upstairs. There's a little area up there, and I can just make an office out of up there. And so we cut the wall out so that we could have all of our Christmas productions that we used to do there. And cut that wall out and then went upstairs. And I remember there was a little window that I used to look out. It was off the floor about that high up. It was a little round. It was the top of the bottom window. That was the window that I had for years and years and years back in that old church. And my wife took a picture of it when she was there. Remember, you used to look out this window? But, you know, I decided when we went in there, God, we're going to use this building for your honor and your glory until you feel fit to bless us with another building. But as long as I'm here, I'm not going to complain. I'm not going to compare. I'm not going to say, oh, I wish. I said, God, we're just going to use this building for your honor and your glory. And we just kept filling it and running it and running it and bringing people in. Eventually, God gave us this edifice. That's a blessing of God. And I've got the biggest window in my office that you ever saw in your life. And I just love it, by the way, as well. The Bible has a theme from Genesis to Revelation, restoration. Luke chapter 4, verse 18. Jesus said these words, and he was prophesying of himself when he stood up and read the word of God that was about him. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free. That's what he came to do. Do we do that at church? Do we proclaim good news to the poor at Praise Tabernacle Church? Do we? We do. We do. Do we proclaim freedom for prisoners? Sure we do. Every Friday night, you maybe didn't realize that. They go into the prisons, Dan Bullock and them go in there. Recovery of sight to the blind? We tell people here that God will open up your eyes spiritually and physically. God can do that. To set the oppressed free. He'll set you free. The Bible says, he who the Son sets free is free indeed. He who the Son sets free is free indeed. I'm going to preach a message in a few weeks. I've been working on it, on that very scripture. He who the Son sets free is free indeed. Because a lot of people claim that scripture, but they're not free. They're not free. But they claim the scripture. But when the Son sets you free, it's different. Can't set yourself free. Religion is not going to set you free. Going to church is not going to set you free. Son has to set you free. Jesus in his teaching and his mentoring and his tactics, he was different. He taught with authority. Did you realize that Jesus always taught with stories? Stories. Got a new sermon series we're going to do starting on Easter Sunday. Actually, we're going to start it just to get people excited about it. But the stories of Jesus, called parables in the Bible. But he always told stories. He used stories of his day with illustration. He connected to the hearts of people so that they would get it. You hear me? So that they would get it. Come into church this morning and go, oh, I'd be sound asleep, man. I tell you. I'd be gonzo. In fact, if it wasn't for God being real, I would never go to church. Never go to church. Seriously. But there's a God that's real today. He's alive and well, and he can bring people from death to life. I'm talking about spiritual death to life. He changes lives. I watch him change lives of people all the time in this church. That's what God does. But if it wasn't for that, if it's just for religion, I'd never go to church. Because I'm not a religious person. A religious person does the same thing the same way over and over and over again. That's just not me. That's just not me. I'm not that way. And especially when it comes to God, you cannot bottle up God. God does not fit into a religious package. Just doesn't. We've seen some of it here today. Jesus was not normal with those that he surrounded himself with. He didn't go and hang out with the religious or the professionals of the day, but he went to men who were crazy enough to believe who he said he was. He didn't fit with the religious system either, and they killed him for it. He laid his life down for the sins of the world. If you will yield yourself to God, you will automatically become more like Christ. If you will yield yourself to Christ. You say, well, you mean, does that mean just going to the altar and say, God, I give my life to you? Well, that's part of it. But after that, you're going to feel the Holy Spirit convicting you of things. Not condemning you, but convicting you. And when you are convicted, you'll know you're yielded if you respond to that conviction. But if you just fight that thing and you want to have your own way, you are not yielded to God. You are not submitted to God. You had a religious experience, not a spiritual experience with Christ. Right now, God is at work within us, all of us, that are in this room. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. But we Christians have no veil over our faces. We can be mirrors and brightly reflect the glory of God. And as the Spirit of the Lord works within us, we become more and more like Him. Be more like Jesus. We used to sing that song, more like Jesus. I want to be more like Jesus. As you allow God to work in your life, it becomes more than just a song you sing or a cliche you will say. It becomes reality. God working on you as you submit to the Lord. Let's become imitators of Christ. I'd like to have every head bowed and every eye closed if you would this morning.